This calls for wisdom. You gotta have some wisdom from God. You can't work this out by yourself. This calls for wisdom. If anyone has insight, and insight comes from the Holy Spirit, I want to tell you tonight, I can sense the anointing of the Holy Spirit upon me tonight. I feel that the Holy Spirit is upon me tonight, and I can feel that the Holy Spirit is giving you insight because he's here. We got 100,000 people here tonight, and they are receiving the Holy Spirit, and God is opening blind eyes.
Paul the evangelist says in the Bible that God will finish his work and cut it short in righteousness. The prophet Joel says God will pour out his Spirit in the last days, and signs and wonders will follow. The Carter Report believes that we are now in the end times, and his Spirit is moving mightily. During the Port Moresby campaign, we testify that we saw the power of God revealed. More than 100,000 God-hungry souls could not get enough of the Word of the Lord, as at creation, the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters, and God brought cosmos out of chaos. Souls were recreated in the image of the Creator. Instead of hate, there was love. Instead of despair, there was hope. Instead of sorrow, there was joy. And in the place of death, God gave life. One night, as John Carter preached on the person and work of the Holy Spirit, the image of a white bird was flashed on the screens. That moment, a great white bird flew low over the astonished congregation. Cries of joy filled the air as the audience recognized that God had visited his people. A mighty surge of Pentecostal power swept the audience of 120,000 souls, and everyone present felt the warm, comforting presence of God. The Carter Report team invites you, my dear viewer, to be a partner in this work. Soldiers of the cross are wanted. Faith partners are needed. Write to us now. Here at The Carter Report, P.O. Box 1900, Thousand Oaks, California, 91358. Or in Australia at P.O. Box 861, Terrigal, NSW 2260. You may also contact us online at carterreport.org or email us at info@carterreport.org.
Ah, there it is. I only have to think about it, and it appears. There we have the period of the Dark Ages, and these dates, my friend, are approximate dates. History doesn't start or close with a date, but that great church became a world power in the year 538 and ruled for 1260 years, and you come through until 1798. That great time period of more than 1,000 years, that great time period of 1,260 years, is what historians call the Dark Ages. The noonday of that great church was the midnight of the world. During the Dark Ages, millions of earnest, devoted Christians were put to death because they would not bend, they would not budge, they would not bow down to Baal, and because they believed in reading their Bibles. Revelation 13, verse 7 tells us that the beast persecutes nonconformists. Revelation 13 and verse 7, I want you to know tonight, I want to be a nonconformist for Jesus. I want to stand with Jesus, even if I'm standing with the minority, because Jesus, one man and Jesus make a majority. Hear what I'm saying? Look at this text. He was given power to make war against the saints. He makes war. The false woman makes war against the true woman. The harlot church makes war against the bride of the Lamb. And there you have a picture of the bloody Spanish Inquisition. It says here, he was given power to make war against the saints and to conquer them. And he was given authority over every tribe, people, language, and nation. He ruled the world. And when he ruled the world, it was a time of darkness and religious terrorism. I would remind you tonight that even though this great church persecuted, the religion of Jesus never persecuted a single soul. God never forces us. You can come into this meeting tonight and you can say, I will not do what God tells me to do. God will never force you. Jesus said, I haven't come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. The religion of Jesus never persecuted a single soul. The fifth identification mark is Revelation 13:2. This church receives her power from the dragon. Revelation 13, verse 2. This is the word of the Lord. The beast I saw resembled a leopard, had a bit of grease, but had the feet of those of a bear, Medo-Persia, and a mouth like that of a lion, Babylon, Antichrist. The dragon gave the beast his power and his throne and great authority. The Bible tells me that this great church did not get his power from Jesus, but this great church got his power from the dragon. Now listen, the dragon is Satan, but Satan works through earthly powers, and in the days of Jesus, Satan was working through the power of pagan Rome. And history tells me that this great religious system got her power not from Jesus, but from pagan Rome. It's going to be hard for you to see that, but it's over there in the city of Rome, and it has there, and if you look at it hard, you can see it says Caesar. It's got the name Caesar, and then it's got his title, Pontifex Maximus. Pontifex Maximus is the title of the Caesars of Rome. The dragon. What happened was the church got all the power of pagan Rome, and pagan Rome was so-called converted, and pagan Rome gave her authority and her power and her prestige to the church. Not the church of Jesus, but the counterfeit church. And if you notice up here, look at this. It's got the name of Sixtus, one of the popes. And it calls him Pontifex Maximus. You can see it with your own eyes. And over here on this screen, you can see Constantine, the Roman emperor, giving his authority to the church. This is history. We're not talking about people living today. We are talking about the facts of history. And Jesus said, you'll know the truth, and the truth will make you free. You see? The dragon gave him his power and his throne and his great authority. Every word of the prophecy came to pass. I tell you, this is the word of the Lord. Now listen. The Bible says that this power would receive a fatal or a deadly wound, as it says in the King James Version. You read about this in Revelation chapter 13 and verse 3. Revelation 13 and verse 3. One of the heads of the beast seemed to have had a fatal wound. People say, when did that happen? I talked about it the other night. This great system ruled the world from 538 right through until 1798. And then General Berthier, one of the generals of Napoleon Bonaparte, marched down to Rome and took the pontiff prisoner after the 1260 years. You say, it's incredible. I can't believe this, my friend. Believe in the God who believes in you. If there's a person here tonight and you've come here and you say, I don't believe the Bible, well, you better believe it now. Because history proves that the prophecies of the Bible are absolutely correct. And just a bit before then, a great Roman Catholic monk by the name of Martin Luther started to preach the Word of God. Now, tomorrow night, I'm going to talk on how long does it take to be saved. Part of that talk is going to be what Martin Luther taught. The best meeting that I give in this entire series, I think, is the meeting tomorrow night. But the preaching of Martin Luther and those great reformers gave to that great church a mortal wound. And did you know this, my Protestant friends? Martin Luther taught virtually everything I am teaching and preaching in these meetings. He said, we must follow the Bible and the Bible alone. And he said that that great church was the power that was described in the prophecies of the Bible. Most churches don't teach it today because they're afraid to teach it. But I want you to know today, we are standing on the Word of God. God help us tonight. And then the next great truth is this, identification mark. The Bible says that that fatal or that mortal wound would be healed. I'm going to read this. There it has, point number 7. But you look at it there in yellow. But the fatal wound had been healed. The whole world was astonished and followed the beast. The Bible says that that great church that went down in 1798 according to Bible prophecy and because of the preaching of the great prophecies of the Bible says that great power is going to come back with all the might, with all the intolerance of the Dark Ages, and that great power is going to enforce the mark of the beast. But I want you to know that Jesus is going to arise in power and strength, and he is going to slay the beast, and he's going to save his people. I want you to know this. I want you to know tonight that we are on the winning side. We have read the back of the book. And we win. Now listen. Point number 8, I think it is. The Bible says that this great church has got a man, and his number is 666. You ready for this? Revelation chapter 13 at the end of the chapter. This calls for wisdom. You got to have some wisdom from God. You can't work this out by yourself. This calls for wisdom. If anyone has insight, and insight comes from the Holy Spirit, I want to tell you tonight, I can sense the anointing of the Holy Spirit upon me tonight. I feel that the Holy Spirit is upon me tonight, and I can feel that the Holy Spirit is giving you insight because He's here. We got 100,000 people here tonight, and they are receiving the Holy Spirit, and God is opening blind eyes. This calls for wisdom. If anyone has insight, let him calculate the number of this church, the beast, for it is a man's number. His number is 666, the number of total apostasy. Listen carefully. There are many superficial preachers in the world today. They've given up preaching these truths because they don't want to appear to be unpopular. I want to say tonight, we're standing on history and we're standing on the truth. What I'm showing you tonight on 666 is the tip of the iceberg. Am I exhausting this? No, no, no. Am I discarding this? No, no, no. I'm going to tell you the truth. History tells me. Glad that you folks are with me tonight. A great crowd of people of all religions here tonight. God loves you. The official title for more than 1,000 years of the leader of that great church. You can read this in all of their literature. My friend, Pastor Harold Harker, has done a tremendous amount of study of these things. He's gone to Rome. He's gone to the archives with other scholars. And this great truth has been acknowledged by some of the greatest scholars of our age and the last 1,000 years. The official title of the leader of the great church. I'm going to put it up here on the blackboard. Here we go. Let's get our camera over here. Vicarious. V-I-C-A-R-I-U-S. Just enough room. Vicarious, that means vicar. Filii. Fili, this is in Latin, of course. Vicarious, filii Dei. And you can read this in the literature of this great organization. In fact, I have a magazine put out by that great church, and it says the official title of the pontiff is Vicarius Filii Dei, which means the vicar of the Son of God. He is the vicar of Christ himself. You say, but are you sure? Absolutely sure. Vicarius Filii Dei. That is the title of the great leader of that church that is called in Bible prophecy the beast. Now we're going to come over here to the blackboard. These Latin letters have numerical value. V is who knows. Come on, tell me loud. Yeah, that's good. V is 5. I is 1. C is 100. A is 0. R is 0, I is 1, U is the same as V, W, this is 5, S is nothing, F nothing, I is 1, L is 50, this is 1, this is 1, D is 500, E is nothing, I is 1. Now we're going to put them up also on the great screens. and you'll see it so plainly that you'll shout hallelujah. Here we've got it. The Kyrios Filii Dei. You add it up and it comes to, there you've got it, 666. Listen, this is only for people who've got insight. This is only for people who have received the anointing of the Holy Spirit upon themselves. Now, let me say something as we go a little further. If that were the only bit of evidence, I would not be arguing this case tonight. But God put it in there so that we would have the final bit of proof, so that we would no longer walk in the darkness. The beast is the great church of the dark ages. The mark of the beast is the mark of that great church that persecutes. Now the next question I've got to get back into teaching mode. What is the mark of the great Roman church? Because that will be the mark of the beast. Before we can discover the mark of the beast, we must discover the mark of God. Because the mark of the beast is a great counterfeit. Every truth that God has, Antichrist has a counterfeit. Instead of the Bible, Antichrist has tradition. The mark of the beast is the counterfeit of the mark of God. God has a mark, which is God's sign or God's seal, his mark of authority. God, I tell you, has a mark. God's seal or God's mark contains three elements. God's name, number one. Number two, God's title. Number three, God's dominion. Now, when a king in ancient times sent out a letter, he put his seal on it. His name, his title, and his dominion. For instance, Barack Obama. That's his name, title, the president, his dominion, the United States of America. Elizabeth, the queen, that's her title. Elizabeth, the title is queen, and her dominion, Great Britain, and her dominions. And so a seal contains three important elements: name, title, dominion. Please don't forget that. Because right now we're going to turn to the commandments of God, because the mark of the beast is the opposite of the commandments of God. Can you see? Exodus chapter 20, verses 8 to 11. And we are looking for God's seal that has his name, his title, and his dominion.
Augustine said, "Our souls were made for God, and they cannot rest until they rest in him. Within every heart, there is a void that only God can fill." This is why so many came to the Carter Report meetings in Port Moresby, Papua New Guinea. The crowds were greater than those attending the Olympic Games in London. They came because everyone is a winner when Christ is Lord. If you, my dear friend, would like to be a faith partner with us in this extraordinary work, or if you'd like to receive a DVD of today's message, please write to John Carter at P.O. Box 1900, Thousand Oaks, California, 91358, or in Australia at P.O. Box 861, Terrigal, NSW 2260. You may also contact us online at carterreport.org. Please include your gift to help light God's candle in dark places.
Remember, I told you before, if you want to escape the mark of the beast, then keep the commandments of God because you love Jesus. Exodus chapter 20, we're going to have a look at it. Exodus chapter 20 and verses 8 to 11. Notice these words. Before we read these words, I would remind you that when God gave the Ten Commandments, he came down in great fire and splendor and majesty on Mount Sinai. He spoke the Ten Commandments with his own mouth, and he wrote the Ten Commandments with his own finger. He came down because we couldn't go up to him. He came down, and he gave us his law, and he gave us his mark. Now, we're looking for God's, what is it, name, his title, and his dominion or territory. Here we go. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. People say, why did God say remember? Because he knew we would forget. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath to the Lord your God. There's his name. On it you shall not do any work, neither you, nor your son, or your daughter, nor your manservant or maidservant, nor your animals, nor the alien within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord, there is his name. The amazing, awesome name of the great creator God, the Lord. He made. If he made it, we have discovered his title. His title is the maker or the creator. The Lord, his name, his title, the maker and his dominion. There it is. Heaven and earth. And it goes on and it talks about the sea and all that is in them. But he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Listen. Listen. Only. Only in the Sabbath do we have the seal of Almighty God. Nowhere else in the scriptures do we have his name, his title, and his dominion. Therefore, I tell you today, I tell you tonight, on the authority of Holy Scripture, the seventh day Sabbath found in the heart of the commandments is the seal or the sign or the mark of God. Now we turn to Ezekiel chapter 20 and verse 12 and 20. Ezekiel chapter 20 and verse 12 and 20. Look now. Look now. Look now. Also, I gave them my Sabbaths as a sign, my mark between us, so that they would know that I, the Lord, made them holy. You say, I was told it doesn't matter. My friend, it matters to God. It is the mark of God. It is the seal of God. It is the sign of God. Then he says here in verse 20, keep my Sabbaths holy. This is not John Carter talking. This is Almighty God talking to you here tonight in this vast auditorium with 100,000 people. Keep my Sabbaths holy, that they may be a sign between us. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God. Listen to me. Listen. I think I should come over here to the blackboard. Just about run out of blackboard, but I'm going to come over here. I'm going to write up. The Bible says the seventh. We've got a camera in here. The seventh day Sabbath. I never said it. God said it. Don't you want to obey God? The seventh day Sabbath is the seal. It is the sign. It is the mark of Almighty God. God says, remember the Sabbath. Now listen. I want you to look at three texts. Genesis 2:1-3. Genesis 2:1-3. Thus the heavens and the earth were completed in all their vast array. By the seventh day, God had finished the work he had been doing. So on the seventh day, he rested from all his work, and God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it he rested from all the work of creating that he had done. In the very beginning of time, when God, look at this beautiful picture, when God made the world, the Bible tells me, right back there in the very beginning of time, the Bible tells me that God blessed the Sabbath day. And the Bible tells me he blessed the seventh day and he made it holy, because it is his day, it is his mark, it is his sign that he is the creator and he is the Lord. Why do we worship him tonight? Because he is the Lord. And that's what the Sabbath stands for. Isaiah chapter 58 and verse 13. Isaiah chapter 58 and verse 13. If you keep your feet from breaking the Sabbath, walking around breaking the Sabbath as people are doing today, and from doing as you please on my holy day, if you call the Sabbath a delight and the Lord's holy day honorable, and if you honor it by not going your own way and not doing as you please or speaking idle words, the Bible tells me that God has got a day. It is his holy day, and that day was given to us so that we would never forget that he is our God, he is our creator, and he sent Jesus to redeem us. Now here's another text I want you to see. Revelation chapter 1 and verse 10. This is in the last book in the Bible. On the Lord's day, I was in the Spirit, and I heard behind me a loud voice like a trumpet. Listen, I'm going to tell you something. Many of my wonderful friends say to me, Christian friends, but that day is Sunday. No, it's not. Jesus never kept the first day. None of the apostles kept the first day. None of the early Christians kept the first day. None of the prophets ever kept the first day. They loved Jesus and they kept the Sabbath day. But then, my friend, after hundreds of years, there came the great state church, and the great state church persecuted the true church. For a long, long time, the great truth of the Sabbath was almost lost. But down through the ages, God has always had a remnant who have remembered to keep holy the Sabbath day. Listen, the seventh day Sabbath is the sign, it is the seal, it is the mark, and the mark of the beast is the great counterfeit. Over here, there is the seal of God, there is the mark of God. But in Daniel chapter 7 and verse 25, we are told that the Antichrist would change the Sabbath and the counterfeit Sabbath is his mark of his authority. I want you to look at Daniel 7, verse 25. He will speak against the Most High and oppress his saints. You know it's true. and try to change the set times and the laws. The only part of the Ten Commandments that talks about times is the holy seventh day Sabbath, the seal, the sign, the mark of God. But the Bible says the great counterfeit church with a blasphemous hand would strike at the very heart of the law of God. Listen. After Martin Luther, there came a great church council, the Council of Trent, called by the popes. And they debated for years. How shall we answer Martin Luther? Shall we do it by the Bible? How can we silence these heretics? Some of the cardinals said, let's go to the Bible. But no. Another cardinal got up and he said, we do not go by the Bible because we, the Catholic Church, change the Sabbath from the seventh day to the first day. And this is the proof that we are the true church, because we can even change the law of God. Can you believe it? More recently, one of the great leaders of the church said, now listen to this, going to put it up on the screen. Of course, the Catholic Church claims that the change was her act, and the act is a mark of her ecclesiastical power and authority in religious matters. They say, we did it. It is our mark. How will the mark of the beast be enforced? In Revelation 13, there is portrayed a picture of a world coming together. I saw another beast coming up out of the earth. He had two horns like a lamb. He spoke like a dragon. This is a power that rises in the last days. He exercised all the authority of the first beast on his behalf and made the earth and its inhabitants worship the first beast, whose fatal wound had been healed. And he performed greater miraculous signs, even causing fire to come down from heaven to earth in full view of man. Because of the signs he was given power to do on behalf of the first beast, he deceived the inhabitants of the earth. He ordered them to set up an image in honor of the beast who was wounded by the sword and yet lived. The image is a copy. He was given power to give breath to the image of the first beast so that it could speak and cause all who refuse to worship the image to be killed. He also forced everyone, small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on his right hand or on his forehead, so that no one could buy or sell unless he had the mark, which is the name of the beast or the number of his name. This is the crisis of the ages. The Bible says, in the last days, there will come a great world government led by this great organization. Church and state will unite, and they will say, we will save the world for God from terrorism. And they will say, you must follow our laws. You must give up the truths of the Bible. You must accept our authority. You must do what we tell you to do. You must surrender your soul to us. And the outward sign of our authority is the counterfeit Sabbath. It's coming. Soon the world is going to be divided into two groups. I've got this in my heart. Christ versus Antichrist. God's law versus man's law. God's Sabbath versus man's Sabbath. Can you not see? Can you not see at last that if you want to escape the mark of the beast, you must follow Jesus and keep the commandments of God, including the seventh day Sabbath, which is the seal, the sign, the mark of God, because you have been washed in the blood of Christ and you are saved and you are filled with the Holy Spirit. Years ago in Australia, there was a little boy who went to some small religious meetings in a little country town. And one night the minister said, "Are there people here who have requests for prayer? We've done this here too." The little boy put up his hand and the minister said, "There's only 30 or 40 people there." "What do you want, little boy?" He said, "I want you to pray for my daddy because my daddy is a drunk and he beats my mummy." What a coward. To beat a woman, what a coward. That's what alcohol does to people. And so they prayed for this little boy's daddy, that he would come to Christ. But there was somebody in that meeting, a church member who talked too much. We have them. And he knew this man, the man who beat his wife. And he went to this man the next day at work and he said, "Your little boy told us all about you. And we're praying for your soul that you'll come to God and repent." And that night, when the father got home from work, he went to his little boy. He said, "You're praying about me down in those stupid religious meetings?" "Yes, Daddy." He said, "If you ever mention my name again, I'll beat you and beat you and beat you to an inch of your life." The little boy kept going to those meetings. He couldn't get God out of his head, and he couldn't get his daddy out of his head. And the father got worse, drank more. One night the minister said, "Are there those who want prayer?" The little boy said, "Yes, I want prayer. I want prayer for my daddy. He's getting worse." And the next day, the same busybody with the long tongue went and saw that man at work. And he said, "Our little boy told us to pray for you." He said, "Jim, why don't you give up the booze? Why don't you give up the drinking? We're praying for you." That night, that man didn't go home, the father. He went to the bar, he went to the pub, he went to the hotel, and he got loaded on alcohol. And when he went home, his wife had stayed up and had his meal in the oven. And the little boy was upstairs in bed. And the man, brave man that he was, he burst in the back door and his wife said, "Jim, here's your dinner." And he shoved her aside and she fell over. And the man went up the stairs and he went into the little boy's bedroom and he got the little boy out. And he took off his belt and he started to beat him, beat him, beat him, beat him. The little fellow was crying, "Daddy, daddy, daddy," and he was beating him. And when the little boy fell over, he gave him a few kicks. And then he rushed down the stairs and out the back door and into the darkness. And the mother stood at the bottom of the stairs. And she was weeping. And after what seemed an eternity, she looked up the stairs, and there was her little boy in his pajamas, stained red with blood. And he held out his arms to his mother, and he said, "Mummy," and he was crying. He said, "Mummy, Mummy, I've just shed my first blood for Jesus." Maybe it's time for some of us to shed our first blood for Jesus. Maybe it's time for us to say, "I'm going to follow Christ. I know people are going to be against me. I know maybe I'm going to be persecuted. Maybe people are going to hate me because I'm going to follow Jesus and keep his commandments. But I'm deciding tonight to shed my first blood for Jesus." I want you to remain seated tonight, and I'm going to pray for you. I don't want you to stand up tonight. I just want you to bow your head, and you'll see why in a moment. But would you please bow your head? What we're going to do, we're going to bring you to God in prayer. Look at me. I can't tell you much more than what I've told you tonight. I've opened my heart to you. I've poured out my soul. I've shown you the prophecy. It's an unpopular truth, but it is the truth of God. Jesus is unpopular in the world today. But tonight, I want to send Jesus a message home. Lord, whatever you tell me to do, Jesus, I'm going to do it. Even if it hurts. Even if I bleed. I want you to remain seated. I want you to bow your heads. And I want you to tell the Lord tonight, you're going to shed your first blood for Jesus. Dear Father, tonight, here we are in this vast, vast stadium. We know that your presence is here tonight. We know that the holy angels of God are here tonight. We know that they're keeping us safe. We know that the devil is mad tonight because the mask has been torn off his face. And tonight, Jesus is holding out his hands to us and he's saying, "If you love me, keep my commandments." Lord, many of us have just been so remiss. We've been so indolent in our faith. We wanted to be named Christians, but we've never intended to follow you. But tonight, Lord, we want to tell you, by your grace, we're going to follow you. We thank you, precious Lord, for coming down and dying for us on the cross. We thank you that you shed your blood for us so that we can be saved by grace. And tonight we want to tell you with that little Australian boy, tonight I'm going to shed my first blood for Jesus. I'm going to follow Christ even if it hurts. Bless these dear people here tonight, Lord, as tonight we tell you that by the grace of God, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. We will get the mark of God on our foreheads. We will go home to glory with Jesus. When the great test comes upon us and is coming any day soon, we are going to stand for Jesus then, because we made up our minds for Jesus now. Bless these people, Lord, for Jesus' sake. Amen.
The Spirit of God today is moving. He is moving wherever human hearts sense their need. He is moving whenever and wherever souls reach out to Him. He is moving because these are not ordinary times. He is moving through the proclamation of His living word. During the Port Moresby meetings, the Spirit of God was powerfully present. One evening, as Pastor John Carter spoke about the Holy Spirit and His work to redeem souls, a huge white bird flew low over the audience. The congregation of more than 100,000 witnessed the sight and believed that God had sent them a sign. Tens of thousands poured forward to accept Christ as Lord and Savior. God today is calling you, as you view this program, to come to Him in faith. The work of the Holy Spirit is not restricted to any one place on earth. Wherever you are, He is there. God loves you. He has a plan for you and a glorious future. Thank you for joining us today. To become a faith partner with Pastor John Carter and to receive our monthly newsletter, write to us here at the Carter Report, P.O. Box 1900, Thousand Oaks, California, 91358, or in Australia at P.O. Box 861, Terrigal, NSW, 2260. That address again is P.O. Box 1900, Thousand Oaks, California, 91358, or in Australia at P.O. Box 861, Terrigal, NSW, 2260. You may also contact us online at carterreport.org. Remember, Jesus said, "You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free."